welcome to the Mean Lady Talking Podcast, the tough-talking, advice-giving show by the not-really-mean, mean lady, Susan J. Elliott.
Good day, everybody. This is Susan Elliott, host of Mean Lady Talking Podcast, and welcome to episode 72. Before we get started, I wanted to thank some new meanies. I want to thank Ashley, who's become a new $9.99 meanie. Thank you, Ashley, and please let me know where to send your bonus. If you don't listen to the podcast on every episode, I've extended the July bonus into August. If you sign up to become a $9.99 meanie, you can have a choice of the Power Affirmations booklet, the GPYP workbook, or a signed copy of Getting Past Your Breakup, a signed copy of Getting Back Out There. If you become a $19.99 supporter, you can have a choice of two of those. So if you sign up, please make sure that you send me your address, meanladytalkin at meanladytalkin.com. I also want to thank Carmen, who's a new meanie. Thank you, Carmen, and welcome to Meanieville. You are in very good company. I also want to thank, again, going in alphabetical order for meanies that I haven't thanked before. I want to thank Elizabeth. I want to thank Jessica. And I want to thank my K meanies. It's good to be a K meanie. We have Ken, Kathy, and Kara. Thank you guys so much for all your support. It really means a lot. I'm looking at my microphone, and my microphone is without a shock mount, and I'm hoping that that doesn't add to my editing time, which is always a lot. A shock mount is what keeps the microphone off the desk. Most microphones come with a little handle that you could put on the desk, but if there's any vibrations on the desk, and even if there's not vibrations, sometimes just talking gives the vibrations. You can hear the vibrations in the recording, and it makes editing even harder than I find it to be, which I've been clocking the editing time, and on the average, a 40-minute podcast takes me 8 hours to edit. So anything that makes it harder is not welcomed. So the shock mount keeps the vibrations off of the recording. But this week, just because I took out the microphone and wanted to plug in the headset, the shock mount literally fell apart in my hand. So this month with Meanie Money, I'll be getting myself a new shock mount. So thank you, Meanie, so much. I'll be getting a new shock mount. I'll be putting a little more money into it. And without you, I couldn't do it. And people have asked me, are you going to continue the podcast past September? And yes, I am. And that is thanks to all of the people that have become meanies. Because I kept the podcast alive for a year and a half by myself, and it ran at a deficit, and there were expenses I didn't plan on, and I just realized I can't continue to do it. So thank you, Meanie, so much. Every cent that you give me goes to the podcast. It will go to continuing to give bonuses. I have to buy the books, and I don't get them at a discount. So all of the Meanie money goes to keep the Mean Lady Talking podcast alive, and I appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you so much. But I want to talk about some things that I've been seeing on the Facebook group and people emailing me and different things that have been going on with my clients. And I've done a lot of podcasts, a lot of articles, a lot of postings in the Facebook group and other places. There's a Getting Past Your Breakup Facebook page. So there's a lot of articles there. And if you go there, please like the page. And I have done so much on personality disorders, but I'm still seeing people doing things that are leaving themselves wide open for a personality disordered person to come into their lives and take advantage of them once again. So I'm going to talk about it on this podcast. I'm also working on a podcast. As you guys know, I don't script my podcast, but I'm outlining one that a meanie requested, which is about going NC with somebody whose personality disorder in your close family, like a parent, a sibling, a really close cousin, something like that. I've been getting a lot of emails about it. So if it has to be a series, it'll be a series. but please email me about your situations going NC with a parent, with a sibling, with all of the above, and let me know so that I can include it on the future podcast. And if you have questions, if you wonder if this person has personality disorders, send them to me. Mean Lady Talking at meanladytalking.com. I'm also starting a group for attachment issues, and the group is going to start September 13th. It's going to be less expensive and less intense than a boot camp, but you're going to learn a lot about attachment, rejection, and abandonment. And I'm going to mention some of the things that I'm going to talk about on this podcast. I'm opening registration for the new group on August 15th. So if you want to join this group, please send me email, susan@gettingpastyourbreakup.com, and I will send you a registration form. Now, like I said, I have done a lot of podcasts on personality disorders, and I'm also working on a future podcast for Chris Watts. And I thought, looking at Chris Watts, and I did the narcissist, sociopath, and psychopath definitions in the Chris Watts podcast that I did. But since then, I've done a lot of research on familicide, which is wiping out your family, filicide, which is killing your children. And as both an attorney and a therapist, it really intrigued me what went on with this guy. And all the people on YouTube who want to blame Shannon Watts for her own murder and the murder of her children are complete and utter wackos. And the blame the victim mentality has got to stop. But in doing my research on Chris Watts, I thought that he would be an anomaly, but he's not. I've actually come across a lot of cases that are very similar to his. And there are people on YouTube that says, okay, well, the people who usually kill their family are drug addicted or this or that or another, and he wasn't any of those things. But I did find cases, and maybe it's because I have other resources, because I belong to the ABA, so I can research all the law journals. I belong to the APA, the American Psychological Association. I can search all of their articles. So maybe I come into articles that other people don't come into because of the cross between legal and psychological. So I'm going to be doing a future episode on that. And I thought that I had beat this personality disordered horse quite dead, but I obviously did not. So I was reading a lot on familicide and filicide, and he's not as unusual as I originally thought. So I want to talk a little bit about things that I'm hearing. And I hope that people listen to me, because I'm not saying this for my health. I got past narcissistic abuse. I got past being attracted to the personality disorder. I healed my attachment issues. I healed my rejection issues. That's the book that I'm working on right now. So I hope that people listen to me. In my boot camps and in the groups that I'm going to be doing, I emphasize observation. I ask people to journal every week. And I ask people to respond to other people's journals, and that's going to continue in the groups. The calls are going to be on Tuesday night at 7:30. Sunday morning is at 10 a.m. Those are the two calls for the groups. If you want to be in the attachment group, please let me know. You must make one of those two calls each week. One of the things that I'm teaching in the attachment boot camp that's going on right now, and I'll teach in the attachment group, is advanced observation. In my boot camps, I always ask my boot campers, pay attention to observation. Read the chapter in the workbook. Really, really, really commit to observation. And then I ask them in their journals, what did you see? What did you notice? What happened? I want to hear observation. You have to ask questions. You have to see if the other person is asking questions. And you have to listen very closely. And you have to not lead. It's not a job interview. With a job interview, you've already checked out this company. You know you want to work there. And you come in and put your best foot forward. And no matter what they say, you try to align yourself with that. And that's kind of how narcissists work on dates. So think about that And don't lead with that stuff. Don't lead with job interview disclosure style. That is not what you want to do. And I talk about the night that I met my husband, Michael, and I pummeled him with questions, And at first, I wasn't interested in him as a potential partner or date. I just started asking him questions, asking him different things. And I always tell people to put yourself out there. Our meeting was completely random. It was completely random. There was no way that the two of us should have been in the same place at the same time. Our lives just didn't normally work that way, but we were. So I was going to a housewarming and I was 2 hours late because I had something else that I was doing that night. So build your life, go out there, see and be seen. I used to date a guy that used to say that. I would say, what are we doing on Saturday night? And he would say, we're going out to see and be seen. So go out and see and be seen. That's how I met Michael. I went out to see and be seen. So I started talking to Michael and we talked for 3 hours and I kind of pummeled him with a lot of questions. The thing that I really liked about him is we started talking about relationship history and he wasn't looking for a relationship and neither was I, which is one of the reasons we were very relaxed with each other, very relaxed, very honest. And he told me that his first wife was an angel. He was young when he married. He was 20 years old. He just got out of service. He had been to Vietnam. And he was very, very traumatized. And he just wanted to forget. So he went off racing. He raced cars and motorcycles. And everybody that knew him said he was very, very, very good. He probably could have made it to NASCAR if he had sponsors or had money, which he didn't have either. But he was at the racetrack a lot trying to, you know, build his reputation and get sponsors and also forget everything else. And his wife wanted to go. And he told me that. He said she wanted to go to the racetrack. And he said, no, you'll be bored, which is something that nobody at the age of 39, which is what I was, would have accepted. And I told him that. I'm like, I wouldn't have accepted that. But I don't think that when he was telling her that, I would have been ready for a relationship with him because I was 14 years old. So no. I was in New York being 14. He was in Boston being 20. We would not have met up. It just wouldn't have been good. But if I was his age or it happened we were a little bit older and I was old enough to date somebody, and we talked about that a lot. We talked about wishing that we had met earlier. But he told me that his first wife was an angel. And he said that he really abandoned her. And after about 8 months of marriage, he came home one day. And there was a note on the table saying she had gone home to her mother. And he didn't blame her. You know, he was like, okay. And he went off to the racetrack. And then he told me that his second wife was just a shit show, basically. And he said that she screamed at him all the time. And she screamed at him all the time and called him names in front of the kids. And as the kids got older, his daughter got older, and the kids were listening to it, he started to tell her, you cannot scream at me the way you do. And Michael was not a yeller. And he said, you can't call me names in front of the kids. And he told me this the very first night. So fast forward to when he did ask me out on a date, and I was interested in him as a partner, I made a mental note. No screaming at him. No screaming at him in front of the kids. No calling him names in front of the kids. But I wasn't going to do any of those things because I already had my standards of compatibility inventory written. I already had my boundaries all set. And every guy I was with since my first husband, I said, you call me one name and I'm gone. Gone. You use the word bitch in front of me and I'm gone. And none of them did. Not even when we were breaking up. It was like they were so respectful. I had somebody who came to a boot camp last year. And as soon as she started dating a guy, she was gone. She was out of the boot camp. And then she told me all this stuff about work hours and this and that. And everything was changed. She couldn't do the boot camp anymore. But it just happened to dovetail with her meeting this other guy. So the boot camp was well underway and she wanted a refund. And I was like, no, I'm not giving you a refund. I think you should finish out the boot camp. And so all she did was call me a bitch. Like, she knew that was something that bothered me. But the fact that that's what she relied on, that's where she went, told me more about her than anything that she said about me. And what happened was she protested the charge with her credit card company, and I gave them all the evidence that I needed to give, that she had signed a thing that said that she realized that there were no refunds and that she had an obligation to be part of the group and to see it through. And the only time that you can get refunds is if the boot camp doesn't start or ends early and I won the case. And part of it was I sent our exchanges to the credit card company. Now, I sounded like a measured and reasoned person in the emails. And she sounded like a lunatic who called me all kinds of names, accused me of all kinds of things. And I was just very even, very measured. And when I sent the emails to the credit card company, they were just stunned at some of the things that she had said. So I take those standards very, very seriously. If somebody starts calling me a name, I'm not calling them a name back. But her calling me a name came back to bite her because the credit card company was absolutely stunned at her behavior. And the woman apologized to me for their cardholder's behavior. That's how bad it was. So back at the ranch, Michael told me that his first wife was an angel, his second wife was a monster, and he wasn't looking for a relationship. But he was very quick to say, but I wouldn't rule it out. And I was like, okie dokie. So I was very impressed with what he told me about his first wife and his second wife. Because when the second wife kept it up, screaming like a banshee, he got up and left. And that was the end of that. Then he asked me for my telephone number. I gave him my telephone number. And then Sunday night, he called me. We talked for like 3 hours. Monday night, he called me. We talked for like 3 hours. And he asked me for a date. And I said, I only go out for coffee or lunch on a first date. And this is a guy that I've been talking to regularly and really liked him at this point. And he said, okay, Wednesday, I'm taking off of work to get my boat fixed. And we had already had the fishing discussion, which I've talked about on another podcast. And he said, I'm taking Wednesday off to get my boat fixed. How about I come down and take you to lunch? Now, I lived in central Massachusetts and he lived right outside of Boston. So it was a bit of a trek for him, but he came. He picked me up at work. He took me out for lunch. And, you know, we went and we talked for a while and then that was it. And then Wednesday night, we talked for 3 hours. Thursday night, we talked for 3 hours. And he asked me if he could take me out for dinner on Saturday night. And he actually made a joke of it. He said, I know that you've got all these rules, which he told me later, he loved that I had all these rules. He said, I know you have all these rules. I don't know how you feel about a second date on a Saturday night. Are you booked? Is there an application? Is there something I need to fill out? He was so funny, so very funny. But he got the drift that there were standards in place and that there was protocol in place. He got that. He got that by me telling him, don't do this, don't do that. If a person does this, and I didn't say you. I said, if a guy calls me a name, that's it. It's over. It's done with. And I put that in when he was telling me about his ex-wife calling him names. I was like, I'm totally on the same page as you. I would absolutely leave. And if you're with a narcissist, they will push. They will push ahead. They want the relationship to move fast. And Michael told me that he fell in love with me the first night and he did want it to move fast. He couldn't believe that he wanted to be in a relationship, but he could see, he could sense from everything that I said that I had a pace and it needed to move in a certain rhythm. And he knew that from me. Now, if he was a narcissist, he would have backed away. It would have been over because I was going too slow. And when he asked me about a third date, I said to him, I want to let you know, because we had had like a wild, hot, steamy makeout session on the second date. And I could tell that he was a very sensual person and that this was going to be a bit of an issue. So I said to him, I just want to let you know that I will not sleep with anybody without STD testing. And he said, where do I go? How do I get it? Blah, blah, blah. And away we went. I said, I'm sure that I don't have an STD, but I think that it's only fair that if I ask people to do an STD test, that I do one as well. And they take a while to come back. And he said that he was so impressed with that. So impressed with that. He said it drove him crazy, but he was so impressed with that. So after the third date, I don't remember what the third date was, but after the third date, he said to me, can I go to work and tell people that you're my girlfriend? And I said, yes. Now we had known each other for about 2 weeks. We had talked on the phone about 3 hours a night, and this was our third date. And he was waiting for the STD testing to come back. Now, when I met my first husband, I was in high school, so it's really hard to gauge this, but he did narcissistic things later on, and he actually did narcissistic things early on. He was an overt narcissist. He was very open. He was very charming. People loved him. He had a sense of humor. I mean, a really great sense of humor. He told jokes like for hours that I've talked about before. And he was a real tough guy. He was the type of guy that would beat the shit out of somebody if they bothered him. He was from Brooklyn. I mean, everybody thought he was so cool. And a lot of people didn't know we were on again, off again, boyfriend, girlfriend, because what we would do is we would hang out together. We'd listen to music and sometimes we'd make out. It was kind of like friends with benefits without sex. It was like we had making out, holding hands, going to the movies. But when we were friends, we did this exact same thing, only we didn't do the making out or the holding hands. So it was kind of a weird relationship, but he wanted to be open to date other girls and have crushes on other girls, and I wanted to be available to guys. So sometimes we told people we were together, sometimes we didn't. A lot of people thought that we were because of the amount of time that we spent together. But there was one point right after high school, like the summer after high school, when he disappeared, completely disappeared. I had no idea where he was. And he had relatives all over the place. He had relatives in Putnam County, New York. He had relatives in Brooklyn. He had relatives in Queens. He had relatives in Florida. I mean, he had relatives everywhere. And he would just bounce from relative house to relative house to relative house. And this should have told me something at the time, but it did not. So this summer, he disappears. And I get into this relationship with a very, very, very abusive guy. I mean, just over the top abusive. And I've talked about him before. I've talked about the fact that he tried to kill me several times. And he was finally arrested for attempted murder for stabbing me. And I testified in front of the grand jury. And it was a typical blame the victim grand jury. All their questions were about, well, why did you go back? They didn't understand that sometimes I went back because I was too scared not to. I really felt like he was going to kill me. It was one of those, if I can't have you, nobody can have you relationships. And I was really afraid that he was going to kill me. And I couldn't get that point across to the grand jury. And a very, very nice New York State trooper came with me to the grand jury, testified. He was the arresting officer. He testified. He was really surprised that I showed up. He didn't think that I would, but I did. But the grand jury didn't indict him. He stabbed me for not cooking him eggs. And the grand jury didn't indict him. And I talked about the other times he tried to kill me. I said he choked me till I passed out in the rain outside. He left me in a puddle that if it would have kept raining, I would have been drowning in this puddle. This was in Georgia. In Georgia, he locked me in a closet for 2 days. In Georgia, he stole my car, which he did that all the time. He did in New York. He did in Georgia. He stole my car and tried to run me over. I ran over to a trellis because I couldn't get in the house because the door was locked and his aunt wasn't home. I didn't know where she was. That's who we were living with. And I jumped up on the trellis and he kept backing up the car and ramming the trellis. The trellis is swaying back and forth. And I'm convinced that if I fall off this trellis, he's just going to run me over and kill me. So that was what was going on while my high school boyfriend, who was what I'll call my ex-husband, was somewhere. So back at Dysfunction Junction in New York, back in my house, my ex, my high school boyfriend, shows up. And he's like, where's Susan? And they're like, she went away with Homicidal, and we don't think she's ever coming back. We don't know where she is, really. And he said that he had an epiphany. He didn't use the word epiphany because he didn't have vocabulary, but he said that he had this awakening that I was the one for him. Years later, he would dedicate the song Bobby Jean from Bruce Springsteen to me. But he said that he had this epiphany that I was the one for him. And when he realized he would never see me again, he was crushed. He was devastated. So there I am in Georgia with a homicidal maniac who's on the lam because there's a warrant out for his arrest in New York because he jumped bail. And I think I'm living in a movie. And I've told this story before. We took a Greyhound bus to Atlanta. It was all very crazy. It was all very movie-like. I really felt like my life was a movie. Because back in Dysfunction Junction, the other person who was missing me was Homicidal's brother, who was a sweet, sweet person. I loved him with all my heart. And he told me he was in love with me, and he rescued me from his crazy brother a bunch of times. And I've got stories about that. But he was a really nice guy, and he rescued me from his brother many times. He was much smaller than his brother, and his brother was a tough guy, homicidal maniac, and he really would have killed him. But his brother said, I'm in love with you. I want to be with you, and I want to find a way to tell the family so that my brother doesn't hurt you. And I told him that I didn't think there was any way to make that possible. So I come back from Georgia. Now, the homicidal ex had wrecked a restaurant. I talked about this on another podcast. I was working. I had wired home after the choking incident because being locked in a closet for 2 days, being run over on the trellis and running through the woods and being raped, that wasn't bad enough. What got me to call my mother to go home was the choking incident. And part of that was because when I woke up, I was near a payphone. And I was just shattered, and I had a little bit of money on me, and I called my mother, collect in New York, and she sent me the money to come home. So being a big mouth, I said, I'm going back to New York, and you're never going to find me because I'm going to the Bronx to live with my father. And he didn't know anything about the Bronx, and he knew there was no way to find me. So that night, I went to work in a restaurant where I was a waitress, and he came in drunk, and he wrecked the place. I mean, literally wrecked the place. And they called the cops, and the cops came, and the cops were trying to scare him. You know, they figured like he was a 17-year-old kid who just got drunk and was upset because his girlfriend broke up with him. And they were trying to calm him down because he was being very belligerent. And he'd been involved with the police all his life. He really wasn't afraid. And he was being very belligerent, but they were chalking it up to the fact that he was drunk. And he, mastermind, they say to him, if you don't calm down, we're going to have to put you in jail. You don't want to go to jail, do you? Thinking that they were scaring him. And he said, if the New York police find me, I'm going to be in jail for a long time. They put his name in the database. Bingo. Here he comes. Now he's being extradited back to New York. Georgia doesn't want him. So I'm going back to New York. Now he's going back to New York. I could not believe it. I could not believe it. I was convinced that if I got back to New York, there was no way that he could get back to New York. But now he's going back to New York on New York at taxpayer money. And I could not convince my mother, no matter what I ever said or did, that those events happened in that sequence. She was convinced that he got locked up first and was being extradited to New York, and then I called her. And that's not the way it happened. So I came back from New York, and his brother checked on me. And as soon as I saw his brother, I just melted into his arms. I was sobbing. I was saying, I can't believe what happened. He wanted to know what happened. I wouldn't tell him. And he kept saying to me, is it that bad? And I was like, yes, it's that bad. So there was a lot of trauma. And when I got back to New York, I didn't want to be with anybody. I did not want to be with anybody. I didn't want to be with high school boyfriend. That's what I'm going to call my first husband because there's a lot of guys involved in this. I want to keep them all straight. I didn't want high school boyfriends. I didn't want brother of homicidal maniac. I didn't want homicidal maniac. I was traumatized. I wanted to be left alone. But my high school boyfriend was so thrilled that I was back that he started love bombing me. And of course, I didn't know anything about that, but that's what he did. He gave me a car. He helped me go to college. He knew I wanted to go to college, and there were a few things that happened that prevented that. And that was one of the reasons why I was with homicidal. So he knew that I wanted to go to college, and he started love bombing me. He said, you're a tough girl from the Bronx. You need a leather jacket. He bought me a beautiful leather jacket. Then he brought me up to the Catskill Game Farm, and I still have pictures of that weekend. And if I can find them, I'll post them on the Mean Lady Talking podcast page at meanladytalking.com, where you can go to become a meanie. So anyway, but narcissists do this. Even very experienced narcissists do that. They share something very precious with you, something from their life. And that's what he did. He shared with me his love of the Catskill Game Farm. And he took me up there and he was sharing all these stories and he was really pulling me in. And he said he loved this place as a child and he didn't want to share it with many people, but he shared it with me. Now, when you first meet a narcissist now, it's going to be a little different because I met high school boyfriend in high school, but they all push for a relationship. And that's what he did. He pushed and pushed and pushed. And I was so traumatized from what happened in Georgia. I did not want to be with anybody. but he just would not take no for an answer. And I was a crazy person, and sometimes I would just act crazy, like, just leave me alone. One night, I went racing down around these curvy, windy country roads in Putnam County, and he chased me. We were doing like 100 miles an hour. And when he caught up with me and I finally stopped and he got into the car, I'm sobbing and he's like, what's wrong? What's wrong? And I'm like, I don't want anybody to touch me. I don't want anyone to be with me. And he wouldn't listen. And we had seen Sybil, the movie, together. And Sybil was Sally Field. And if you've never seen it, you should see it. It's a great movie. But in one of her multiple personalities, she goes, break glass, break glass, break glass. So that night when we were racing at 100 miles an hour, he's saying to me, break glass, break glass, break glass. Like he was trying to inject humor into the situation. It was not funny and I was not amused. But I was seriously traumatized and I didn't want to be with anybody, but I loved my high school boyfriend and I loved Homicidal's brother and I was scared to death of Homicidal. But I just wanted to be left alone and they just wouldn't leave me alone. So what my ex-husband did, my high school boyfriend, ex-husband slash ex-husband did, it's called stacking. It's what narcissists do. They stack one thing after another, after another, after another. So you come to trust them. When it's in the beginning, like it's on a date, they'll do different things that really ingratiate you to them. You really start to like them and trust them. And they tell you things like, I trust you, even though it's hard for you to say, I trust you to somebody you don't know. But they'll say that because if they say, I trust you, you're not going to suspect them of anything because they trust you. You really need to know how they normally behave before you can really establish a baseline and figure out if they are love bombing, if they're stacking, if they're doing a lot of the traditional things that narcissists slash sociopaths do. I've told the story of my friend. I was living in Manhattan. Michael had come in from Texas. We had a 2-year long distance marriage. We couldn't sell the house in Texas. I was living in Manhattan and Michael came in from Texas and my best friend and her boyfriend, we were going up to Connecticut to meet them. And we got off of the train. Now, I had been to this train station many times. And it was a small parking lot. Some of the commuter stations around New York City are very large. But this one was pretty small. And if I got off the train, I would recognize her car and walk over to it. It wasn't a big hike. It wasn't a big deal. But they were waiting on the platform. Now, this is something that a sociopath slash narcissist will do. They'll do something out of the ordinary to really pull you in. So they're waiting on the platform, which I thought was weird because I had gone up there many times and I met her in the car. But now the boyfriend's idea is that he's meeting us on the platform. He's being very, very open. And he looked like he wanted to hug me, but I'm not a huggy person and neither was Michael. So he did the handshake thing. And that's one thing that narcissists slash sociopaths will do. They will figure out just by reading you that you are either a huggy person or a handshake person, and they will do the exact right thing. It's one of those things that they have from reading people. Okay, I'm going to go to part 2, and we will continue this discussion.